Good morning students, welcome to today's chemistry class. So this is a extra class of chemistry because some portions of the chapter 3 was not completed. So we will be completing that remaining portions today. So I hope that all of you have downloaded that question answers from the school website and started to complete also. So today the objective type question answers will also be posted. So it is requested that go there and download that portion also. So I hope that all of you have completed objective type questions in your book. So it's go there, download the answers and match the answers. Okay. So let's start with our 10th separation technique, that is chromatography. So what is this chromatography? What this technique is all about? The process of separating the constituents of a colored mixture. So it is used for the colored mixture by their adsorption over an appropriate adsorbing material. So it is used for colored mixture which adsorb over an appropriate adsorbing material. Okay. So by chromatography, we can separate two or more solids from one another provided they are soluble in the same solvent. So these are the condition. They should be colored mixture, then they should be soluble in the same solvent. Two or more solids should be soluble in the same solvent, then only the chromatography technique can be used. So the solvent which can be used is to be pure. Example, pure liquid like water, alcohol or acetone, or a mixture of two or more of these. So these are the solvent, water, alcohol, acetone, or the mixture of two or more can be used, but it should be in the pure state. Okay. Now this method works on the principle of adsorption. So in the definition also you came across this term adsorption. So let's see what this adsorption is all about. So adsorption is a surface phenomenon. Okay. So this is a process which occur on the surface. Okay. Not throughout, but only on the surface, in which a substance is bound to the surface of another by a weak force. Okay. So it is a surface phenomenon in which a substance is bound on the surface of another. Okay. If a mixture is there, then its components will be bound to the surface of another substance by a weak force. Okay, that force will be weak, not strong. So example, you can take a milk is held on the surface of paper towel. So what happened by mistake, if you spill milk on a paper towel, then what you observe, that liquid spreads on the surface. Okay, and that liquid spreads because it is a surface phenomena. It spreads on the surface means it is adsorbed. Milk is adsorbed on the paper towel, and hence it is a surface phenomena. And the milk is held on the surface of paper towel by a weak force. Okay, the milk is adsorbed on the surface of paper towel by a weak force. Okay, so let's see, that substance that is adsorbed is called what? Adsorbate. So milk which is adsorbed on the surface will be what? Adsorbate. And the one at the surface of which it is adsorbed is called adsorbent. So here milk is what? Adsorbed. So it will be what? Example of adsorbate. And paper towel is the substance, or you can say the substance on the surface of which the milk is adsorbed. So that is known as adsorbent. Similarly, if you take ink and filter paper, so as soon as ink will fill on the surface of filter paper, it will start to spread. Okay, so it is a surface phenomena, means what? Ink is adsorbed on the surface of filter paper. So ink will be what? Adsorbent. And the surface of which it is adsorbed will be what? Filter paper. And it is known as adsorbent. So I think that's adsorbate and adsorbent meaning is clear. Okay. So in chromatography, we generally use cellulose, silica or alumina as adsorbent. So these different adsorbent is used in different type of chromatography. It's not necessary that all the three adsorbent will be used in the same form of chromatography. In the coming part, you will learn there are various types of chromatography also. But in your class, you are learning only about one simple type of chromatography, which is known as paper chromatography. So in paper chromatography, we generally use cellulose as adsorbent. Okay, silica or alumina is used as adsorbent in other types of in paper chromatography. Cellulose is used in the form of blotting paper, filter paper, or specially made chromatographic paper. So specially made chromatographic paper is generally Wattman 41. Okay, so I've told you that in the paper chromatography, special type of adsorbent is used, and it is made up of what? Cellulose. So that example is what? Blotting paper. Because blotting paper, filter paper, or chromatographic paper, all are made of what? Cellulose. So such type of adsorbent is used in the case of paper chromatography. Okay, so what happened when filter paper or blotting paper or chromatographic paper comes in the contact of liquid? So let's see what happens when a filter paper or a blotting paper is soaked in a liquid. It starts to spread over paper by moving upward even against gravity due to capillary action. So this is what happens when liquids drop, or you can say if a blotting paper or filter paper comes in the contact of liquid. So as soon as it comes in the contact, comes in with the contact of liquid, so what happens? Liquid starts to spread over paper, and that spreading is there by moving upward. So what you will see, liquid will start to spread and it will move upward, and as you know that gravity acts downward, but it moves upward, which is against the gravity. And why it is happening? It is due to the capillary action of the pores which is present in the filter paper or a blotting paper. Okay, so capillary action is the action shown by the liquid by moving upward direction, which is against the gravity. Okay, so I think that this chromatography is clear. Now let's see how separation of dyes of an ink by paper chromatography takes place. Okay, so this is an experiment which will clarify about paper chromatography. So let's see what are the steps involved in this. This is given in your question answer also, so understand it how it happens. So first of all, a long strip of a chromatographic paper is cut out. Okay, so it can be filter paper also, blotting paper also, or special type of chromatographic paper also. So one long strip is cut out. Okay, as you can see in the figure, a long strip is there. Okay, next, what has happened? A drop of ink, so here we are taking an example of green ink, okay, is placed about a centimeter from one end of the strip and dried. Okay, so ink spot will be here, it will be somewhat some centimeter above from the end of the strip. So this is the end of the strip, and the spot is being placed over some centimeter above from the end of the strip, and then it is kept for drying. Directly we don't use for the chromatographic technique, we let the drop of the ink to be dried. Okay, after that what has happened? A very small amount of solvent is taken in a jar. So you can see the level of the solvent, level of solvent is very less. Okay, a very small amount of solvent is taken in a jar. Okay, it is a closed jar. Then what happened? The paper strip is suspended in the jar such that the end near which the ink is placed just touches the solvent. Okay, so now what has happened? The strip which we have prepared by dropping the ink and by drying the ink, what we are doing? We are hanging it with some support. We will hang it such that the ink just touches the solvent, it should not get dipped into the solvent. Okay, that precaution we have to take. The ink spot should not get dipped in the solvent, instead it should just touch the layer of the solvent. Okay, it should not dipped. Otherwise, the technique will fail. Okay, paper chromatography technique will not able to take place if this ink spot get dipped into the solvent. Then the whole setup is left undisturbed for some time. Okay, the result will not be seen spontaneously. It is left for some time undisturbed. The setup is left undisturbed for some time. Then after some time, one can observe the green ink spot has moved up the strip and separated into two colors. So you can see the green ink spot is moved up and now it is separated into two colors, blue color spot and yellow color spot. Okay, separated into two colors, or you can say two dyes are now being separated from the green ink. So first of all, one spot will be here. Okay, dry mixture, standard dry mixture is taken. Then after that, what will happen? The green ink spot will move out. Okay, it will show some movement. Then after that, you will see the splitting of the dyes. So green color is generally made of blue color and yellow color. Okay, so this is a mixture of the dyes. So they will get separated. Okay, and you can see the spots separately. Okay, so same process can be taken, can be done for other color ink also and for other thing also. Okay, we can separate the extract of the leaf also. Okay, in extract of the leaf also some of the components are there which can be separated by the chromatography technique. Okay, so you can see here in the figure which is shown downward, some other color ink spots are also being taken, and after chromatographic technique, the different dyes, the inks are now separated into different color dyes. Okay, you can see here. So likewise, the paper chromatographic technique can take place. Okay, next. Now why this separation happens, why this separation of dyes takes place. Okay, this happens because the different dyes with different coloring substance are held, or you can say adsorbed. Okay, holding means what? Getting adsorbed. Different dyes with different coloring. Okay, with I have left here. Different dyes with different coloring substance are held or absorbed by the absorbent with different force. Okay, with different force they are held. Okay, so the ink is mixture of different color dyes, but they are held by the absorbent by different force. Then what is happening? The pigment which is held less strongly is driven faster by the solvent. Okay, so pigment which was held less strongly will move faster, and the pigment which was held more strongly by the absorbent will move less. Okay, so speed of the movement of the pigment is totally depends upon the strength with the pigment is held by the absorbent. If the pigment is held less strongly, then it will move faster, and if it is held more strongly, then it will move less. Okay, the speed will be less. Okay, so as a result, the different pigments move over adsorbent surface with different speed under the influence of the solvent. So it is because of the solvent. Okay, this happens in the influence of the solvent. The different pigments move over adsorbent surface with different speed. And now you have understood why there is a difference in speed, because different pigments are held differently with different strength. Okay, different pigments are held with a different strength by the absorbent surface. Some are held very strongly, some are held less strongly. Okay, so less strongly held pigment will move fast. Okay, and more strongly held pigment will move slow. Okay, so the array of colors on a chromatographic paper is called a chromatogram. Okay, so whatever array of color means arrangement of the color you get on the chromatographic paper, that is known as chromatogram. Now the mixture of different color ink will give more colorful chromatogram as shown. So you can see here, so this ink spot is mixture of different color ink. Okay, so that is why it is separated into colorful pigments. It has been separated into different color pigments because it is a mixture of different color pigments. Okay, so likewise the chromatographic technique takes place, especially paper chromatographic technique, because we have talked about thin layer chromatography, or you can say paper chromatography. So I think this chromatographic technique is clear. Next, now we have got the strip of colorful dyes. Okay, then what is done next? Small strips of different colors are cut out from the main strip, and coloring matter can be obtained by dissolving it in the solvent and then evaporating the solvent. So we have got here chromatogram of different color dyes. Then what is done next? The different color dyes strip will be cut. Okay, so we will cut this yellow, this pink, orange, blue separately, small strip we will cut, and then we will dissolve this pigment into a solvent. We will take different solvent we will take, and different pigment will be dissolved in different solvent, and after that by evaporation we will get the pigment separately. Okay, like this we separate the pigments. Then in chromatography, the adsorbent part is called the stationary phase. So this paper is what? Stationary phase, because it does not move here and there, it is at its own place. So this adsorbent is known as what? Stationary phase. Then, and the thing that moves solvent and solution is known as mobile phase. So the solvent which we have taken in a jar is what? Mobile phase, because it only moves. As you can see here, solvent has moved up. So this is moving, that is why this solvent or solution will be what? Mobile phase. Okay, so there are different types of chromatographic technique developed on the basis of type of phase. Okay, so on the basis of these phase only, different type of chromatographic techniques has been developed. So some of the types are column chromatography, gas liquid chromatography, in short we say it as GLC, high proficiency liquid chromatography, in short we say it HPLC. Okay, so these are the various types of the chromatography which are devised on the basis of type for phase. Okay, so what is this column chromatography? In it, the stationary phase is a column of adsorbent which is packed in a vertically placed white tube. So about this column chromatography you will be learning in higher class. Okay, just you know that in column chromatography we are taking adsorbent in the form of column. Okay, it is a white tube, and in that the adsorbent is packed. Okay, it is vertically placed wide tube in which adsorbent is packed. So I think the whole thing about paper chromatography is clear. Okay, so let's move to our next topic. Okay, so in your book some of the separation methods are given. Okay, table 3.3 on page number 30, some of the separation, some of the types of mixture are there, and then it is given when it can be applicable, and some of the examples are also given. So it is suggested that you read table 3.3 in your book. Okay, start learning about how these mixtures will be separated and when they can be applicable. Okay, and some of the examples of the techniques you can learn from the table. Now separation of mixture, a few examples are given. Okay, so how to choose a method for separating the components of a given mixture. So some examples of the mixtures are given, and then we have to think that how the components of the mixture can be separated. So let's see one by one how these mixtures can be separated into its component. So first is a salt and water mixture. So it's very easy. So by filtration or distillation we can separate salt and water separately. Okay, distillation method already you know that sand will be in be what? Round bottom flask, and then water will be received in a receiver flask. Then in filtration technique, sand will be obtained as a residue in the filter paper and water will be in a flask. So like this, by filtration or by distillation technique, we can separate sand and water mixture. Then next is a salt solution. Now salt solution can be separated by distillation or by evaporation, but by evaporation water will be lost as vapor, so it will be suggested to separate salt solution by distillation if we want to obtain both salt and solvent. Okay, both salt and solvent, then what we have to opt for? We have to opt for distillation. But if we want only salt, then we can opt for evaporation technique. Okay, next is a salt sand mixture. Okay, salt and sand mixture, how it can be done? So first of all, we will dissolve salt and sand mixture in the water. So what will happen? Salt will be dissolved, and then when we will filter the mixture, then what will happen? Sand will be obtained as residue on the filter paper, and salt will go through what? Filtrate. Salt will be obtained in the filtrate. Then after that, when we will evaporate the filtrate, we will obtain salt. Okay, like this separation we can do. Next, sugar chalk mixture, same way we can do. So sugar and chalk, sugar is soluble in water, so we will dissolve this sugar and chalk mixture in the water. Sugar will be dissolved, and on filtering what will happen? Chalk will be obtained as residue in the filter paper, and sugar will go into filtrate. Then on evaporation or by crystallization, sugar can be obtained. Okay, both technique can be used. Next, an iron filling sawdust mixture. So it's very well known that iron is a magnetic substance. Then iron filling can be separated by magnetic separation, and sawdust will be remain behind. Okay, next, iron filling separate sulfur mixture. So iron filling can be separated by magnetic separation. So this is one method by which we can separate iron fillings from the sulfur by magnetic separation. Next, we know that sulfur is soluble in carbon disulfide, but iron filling is not. So when we will dissolve the mixture of iron filling and sulfur in carbon disulfide, sulfur will be dissolved, and on filtering, iron fillings will be obtained as residue on the filter paper, and sulfur will be obtained in the filtrate. Then on evaporation, we will get sulfur back. On evaporation of filtrate, we will get the sulfur back. Okay, so this is the next method by which we can separate iron fillings and sulfur. Next, a carbon sulfur mixture. So same way, sulfur is soluble in carbon disulfide, and carbon is not soluble in the carbon disulfide solution. So when we will dissolve carbon and sulfur mixture in carbon disulfide, sulfur will be soluble but carbon will not. Then on filtering, will be obtained carbon on the filter paper as residue, and sulfur will be obtained as in the filtrate. Then on evaporating the filtrate, we will get sulfur back. So by this we can separate carbon and sulfur mixture. Next, water oil mixture. So water and oil is what? Are what? Immiscible liquids. Okay, they are not mixed with each other. So simply we can use separating funnel. So the method will be same as we have discussed in the previous class. Okay, water and oil mixture will be taken in the separating funnel. It will be shaked, then it is left behind for it to settle down, and then by opening the knob one by one, water and oil can be separated in different containers. Next, a benzene and toluene mixture. So both liquids are volatile, means they are prone to get evaporated quickly. So but there is difference in the boiling point. Okay, so there is a difference of 20 degrees Celsius. Okay, in the last class we have seen benzene and toluene, so there is a difference of 30 degrees Celsius. Okay, and we can use fractional distillation if the difference between the boiling point is 20 degrees Celsius or more. So here the difference between the boiling point is 30 degrees Celsius and it is very close. That is why we will use what? Fractional distillation for separating benzene and toluene mixture. Next, an ink mixture. Just now we have studied by paper chromatography. Next, salt, sand and sulfur mixture. Now three components are mixed together and we have to separate them one by one. So what we will see here? First of all, what we can conclude? Salt is soluble in water and sulfur is soluble in carbon disulfide. But sand is not soluble in any of the two. So what we will done first? First of all, we will dissolve the mixture of sand, salt and sulfur in the water. So what will happen? Sand will be dissolved in the water and on filtering, sand and sulfur will be obtained as residue and salt will be obtained as filtrate. Okay, salt will be obtained in the filtrate. Next, what will we do? We will dissolve sulfur and sand mixture in carbon disulfide. So sulfur will be dissolved in the carbon disulfide solution, okay, and sand will not. Then on filtering, what we will obtain? Sand as the residue on the filter paper and sulfur will be obtained in the filtrate. Then we have obtained sand separately on the filter paper. Finally, we have got what? Sand on the filter paper and sulfur and salt are separately dissolved in the carbon disulfide and water. Then what we will do? We will evaporate these two filtrate separately and then what we will get? Salt and sulfur. Okay, salt and sulfur can be recovered by evaporating the solvent one by one. Okay, so these techniques are written in a book also, you can read them. Okay, now next is a carbon sulfur nitre mixture. Okay, so this mixture is used in gunpowder. Okay, gunpowder is an explosive containing carbon sulfur and potassium nitrate. So nitre is also known as potassium nitrate. So what we can conclude in this mixture? Only sulfur is soluble in carbon disulfide and only nitre, that is potassium nitrate, is soluble in water. So sulfur and nitre can be dissolved out successfully in carbon disulfide and water. Okay, so same technique we will use. We will dissolve sulfur. Okay, first of all we will take the mixture of carbon, sulfur and potassium nitrate. We will dissolve in the water. So what will happen? Potassium nitrate or nitre will get dissolved and carbon and sulfur will be obtained as residue. Then next we will dissolve carbon and sulfur in the carbon disulfide. What will happen? Sulfur will get dissolved and carbon will be obtained as residue. Then as we have obtained filtrate separately, what we will do? We will evaporate the filtrate which contain sulfur and nitre separately. Then we will get sulfur and nitre, okay, by evaporation of the filtrate, and carbon will be left as the residue. Okay, so like this separation is achieved. So explanation is given book also, you can go through the book. Okay, next is the last topic which was left, difference between a mixture and compound. So we have already studied about mixture and compound and here are some of the differences. So question is given in your book also. So let's see some of the differences. Mixture is an impure substance but compound is a pure substance. Then next, the compounds can be present in any proportion and the components can be present in any proportion in mixture, but in the case of compound, the constituents must be present in a fixed proportion. So these you have already studied in the characteristics of mixture and compounds. So using the characteristics of mixture and compounds only, we have differentiated mixture and compound. Then next difference, the third one, the components show their individual properties. In the case of mixture, the components show their individual properties. In the case of compound, the constituents do not show their individual properties. As compound will form, what will happen? The constituents will not show their individual properties because new substance has been formed. Next, in the case of mixture, the components can be separated by a physical means. Okay, so this you have already studied. Till now we were studying about some of the mixtures and they were all separated by a physical means. But in the case of compound, the constituents cannot be separated by a physical means. Okay, so constituents cannot be separated by physical means, only by chemical means only they can be separated. So these are all the four differences, okay, you need to learn. Okay, so by this we have completed our chapter. Okay, I hope the chapter is clear to you all. Read the chapter in your book, start writing question answers. Okay, and I want to tell you that we have completed the first three chapters. So it is requested that you go through your book, read your book, and start underlining important points. Okay, some of the questions will be formed in between of the books also. So it is expected that you underline important points by yourself. Okay, and when school will reopen, then we will be discussing some important questions. Okay, so now I want to discuss about summer assignment also. So let's discuss about summer assignment. Okay students, let's talk about the summer assignment. Okay, so the topic which I am going to give for the summer assignment is draw and describe structure of graphite, also give some of its properties and uses. Okay, so this assignment work you have to do in your summer time. Okay, and it should be done in a separate copy, and it should be an interleave copy. So you can use any copy, okay, but it should be interleave. So in order for drawing the diagram of the structure of the graphite, so in your book it is given in the carbon chapter. Okay, carbon chapter, which is the 9th chapter. Okay, it is given on page number 97. Okay, so some ideas you can take from this portion of the page. Okay, so it's given about graphite properties, structure and uses. All the three are given, and structure of the graphite is also drawn. But it's not necessary that you do the exact same thing. You search from your internet, okay, some other properties, some other structure. Okay, so structure should be drawn properly. Okay, so you just search for the well labeled diagram of the structure of graphite and do that. Okay, you should not simply copy from the book. Okay, you can take idea from the book, but it should not be a copied work. Okay, it should look like some assignment work. So you go through the book from the carbon chapter, and in that about graphite it is given. So I think now this assignment work is clear. So this will be mentioned in the school website also. So the objective type questions I am going to give, in that only I will mention about the assignment work which you have to do. Okay, so after getting this, start doing this also. Okay, and when school will reopen, we will be collecting your assignments. Okay, so I hope that all the three chapters are clear. If anything is unclear to you, go and re-watch that video and try to understand and complete all your works. Okay, whatever questions we have given, long answer, short answer, objective type questions, everything, do it, draw the diagrams, everything. And other questions, means extra questions with which has to be given, will be given when school will reopen. And class tests will also be there. Class test of the third chapter will be there. Okay, so remember that class test of the third chapter which we have just studied, it is element compounds and mixture. So start learning all the question answer, and class test will also be there. So with this, I would like to conclude chemistry classes. Okay, thank you.